Good morning, I am Antonello Starita and I am Associate Professor of Manufacturing at the University of Naples, Federico II. I am also part of the IMAS District, the Italian District for Material Science and Technology, and I will deliver this presentation on friction stir welding. This is a short outline of this course. This course will last more or less 1 hour and we will touch the following topics. We'll start from a brief introduction of the joining of materials and on welding processes. Then we'll speak in details about friction stir welding, including the process scheme, the main process parameter, the defects that we can have, the equipment used. We will give also some information regarding the tool design and the materials to be used for tool construction. Then we'll speak about typical defects. We'll describe the advantages and disadvantages of the process. Then we will see which equipment can be used to perform friction stir welding. At the end, we'll present some special application that can be of interest. And this lecture will end with some answer to some frequently asked questions. So, let's start with this lecture. Joining includes welding, brazing, soldering, and adhesive bonding of material. In this lecture, we will focus on welding. Welding produces a permanent joint between the parts to be assembled. This joint cannot be easily separated by the application of forces and cannot be disassembled easily. So, these kind of joints are referred as permanent joints. These kind of techniques, welding for instance, are used to assemble many parts to make a system. In modern industry, the needing to assemble dissimilar materials is increasing to produce lightweight structures with materials with optimized and tailored properties in different area of the part, depending on the different needings in terms of mechanical resistance, corrosion resistance, and so on. So these welding techniques are gaining an increasing interest in modern industry and in modern research. Welding is a metal joining process in which two or more parts are joined or coalesced at their contact surfaces by suitable application or heat and pressure or both of them. Sometimes welding is done just by applying heat alone with no pressure applied. In some cases, both heat and pressure are applied, and in other cases, only pressure is applied with any external heat. In some welding processes, a filler material is added to facilitate the coalescence. In some other, no filler material is required. In this presentation, we are going to focus our attention on a solid-state welding technique in which forces are applied to the place to be joined. Welding processes can be classified in two main categories: fusion welding and solid-state welding. In fusion welding processes, heat is applied to melt the base metals. In many fusion welding processes, a filler material is added to the molten pool during welding to facilitate the process and provide strength to the welded joint. When no filler material is used, that fusion welding operation is referred to as autogenous weld. Within the fusion welding techniques, we can include arc welding, resistance welding, oxygen gas welding, electron beam welding, and laser welding. Usually, the most concentrated is the heat source, the better is the welding we obtain. So, usually, electron beam welding and laser beam welding are very costly welding techniques that are used for high performances application. In solid-state welding, joining is done by coalescence resulting from application of pressure or for a combination of heat and pressure, as we will see, and the heat can be generated in various methods. Even if heat is used, the temperature in the process is less than the melting point of the metals being welded. So, for this reason, these kind of weldings are called solid-state technique, because no fusion occurs, so the materials to be welded remain in solid state during all the processes, avoiding some of the defects that we have due to the fusion and resolidification of the material. No filler metal is used. The main solid-state joining techniques are diffusion welding, where two part surfaces are held together under pressure at elevated temperature, and the parts joined by solid-state diffusion. Then we have friction welding or friction stir welding, where the joining occurs by the heat generated by friction. We will see how this friction will be achieved, and a plastic deformation between the two surfaces. Then we have the ultrasonic welding, where moderated pressure is applied between the two parts to be welded. So this oscillation motion results in ultrasonic frequencies that leads to the joining of the contacting surfaces. As mentioned before, one of the advantages of solid-state welding is that no fusion occurs, so the microstructure is more controlled, because one of the disadvantages of fusion welding is that the microstructure in the welded joints, in the weld bed, is different with respect to the microstructure of the base material, and sometimes this leads to a reduction of mechanical and electrochemical properties. In solid-state techniques, we don't have this kind of resolidified microstructure, so we can better retain the starting microstructure. What is more, as we will see in the next slides, sometimes we can achieve a microstructure that is better than the starting one by obtaining recrystallized grains with a smaller dimension and with higher mechanical properties. The first application of frictional welding and all the solid-state welding techniques were in aerospace industry, because in these industries the needing for new technologies able to achieve lightweight structure made of the similar material are extremely important. So the frictional welding found its first application in aerospace industries. Then nowadays we can find out some application on automotive, on ship construction, and on train construction. So frictional welding is going from the space to the ground transportation application, passing through the sea transportation application. We'll see here some example of aircraft and of space vehicles, where the primary structure that is welded by frictional welding. For instance, Eclipse Aviation, in producing their small vehicle, replaced the riveting with frictional welding. An aircraft fuselage is mainly made of three parts: the fuselage, the skin, the frame, and the stringers. All that parts are usually joined by riveting, with all the difficulties that this process involves. So, by replacing riveting with the frictional welding, you can reduce the weight of the aircraft, you can obtain a more simple and more lean process, and you can save money, time of fabrication, and weight of the aircraft. So this is a typical example of frictional welding application in aerospace industry. Another aerospace application is the welding of the reservoirs of fuel of Delta rockets. These reservoirs are made of metal, and the joining are made by frictional welding. The use of this technique allowed to reduce the weight of these parts, and as you can see, in a space application, to reduce the weight is a huge saving of money and a huge saving of propellants. So the first flight of this component welded by frictional welding is in the late 90s. So the very first application of frictional welding were, as we have seen, in aerospace and aeronautics applications. Then we will see at the end of this presentation same automotive applications. In the last years, frictional welding has been introduced also in shipbuilding, because new machine and new tool allow to weld higher thicknesses. So it's a technology that now can be used also for naval application, for joining of big pieces of primary structure. In the next part of this lecture, we'll speak about the process generalities of frictional welding. We'll start from physical and theoretical basis of the process, then we'll speak of the metallurgy of the joints, we will introduce the most important process parameters, the most used welding configuration, then we will discuss the forces acting on the tool during the process. First of all, let's introduce the process scheme, which is extremely simple. Referring to a butt welding configuration, the parts to be joined must be firmly clamped to avoid the movement of the part during the process. Then, a rotating tool that in the first application was made of hardened steel, but now more material with higher performances are used, is driven within the joint and transversed along the joint line between the parts. This should be operated by a proper machine. At the beginning of frictionless welding, milling machine with some modification were used. Now, dedicated equipment and fixtures for frictionless welding have been conceived and are currently commercialized. Then, this rotating tool produces friction with the parts, generating enough heat and deformation to weld the part together. The idea is that the heat generated through the friction of the tool against the part to be joined generates heat. So this heat softens the material, and this softened material is stirred by the action of the tool. So this results in a remixing of the material that, be careful, the heat is not enough to melt the material, but is enough to soften the material, so the tool can act two different roles. The first one is to generate heat through the friction. The second one is to mix and stir the softened material, then results in a mechanical joining of the two parts. Now fusion occurs and a huge plastic deformation occurs. This huge plastic deformation leads, as we will see, to the formation of highly deformed grains and fully recrystallized grains with mechanical properties higher than one of the base material. In friction stir welding process, a special tool mounted on a rotating probe travels down through the length of the base material plates in face-to-face contact. The interference between the welding tool and the metal to be welded generates the plastical deformed zone through the associated stirring action. At the same time, the thermomechanical plasticized zone is preceded by friction between the tool shoulder and the top plate surface, and by contact of the neighbor material with the tool edges, including plastic deformation. The friction stir welding process can be roughly described by three stages: plunge, dwell, and translational stage. During the plunge stage, a non-consumable rotating tool is slowly plunged into the joint line between the two materials to be welded. Once the tool reaches the required depth, it's held in position for 5 to 20 seconds while still rotating. This is called the dwell stage. The purpose of this stage is to soften the workpiece material ahead of the tool before welding. During the translational stage, the tool traverses along the joint line of the two workpieces, leaving behind a fully consolidated joint. So, in this process, we can also find two different areas, the advancing side and rotating side, because the tool is rotating and is at the same time moving. So, we have a part of the joint where the peripheric speed of the tool has the same versus and direction of the travel speed, and on the opposite side, the peripheric speed of the rotating tool has a versus that is opposite with respect to the versus of the travel speed. The first area is called advancing side, the second one is called retreating side. This asymmetry leads to mechanical properties that are slightly different in the two parts of the joints welded. The tool is made of two main parts, the shoulder and the pin or probe. The shoulder is the part with the higher diameter, and the role of the shoulder is to generate the frictional heat. The tool is plunged against the two surfaces to be welded, and of course is rotating. This motion generates, thanks to the friction between the shoulder and the surface of the parts to be joined, the frictional heat. This heat softens the material, and the role of the probe or pin is to stir and mix this softened material. So, the plastic deformation can be divided in two parts: the forging force and the extrusion force. The forging force is the action of the shoulder that plunges the material and acts like a forging process. Then the extrusion is the one exercited by the pin, because the material is a kind of extruded between the rotating pin and the part of the plates to be welded, which are not softened because are far from the zone with the heat is generated. So the remixed material experiences a kind of extrusion confined by the rotating pin and the part of the material which has not been softened. This very complex plastic deformation generates the fully recrystallized grain that we will observe in the next slides. The process can be divided in four fundamental phases. The first phase, the primary plunging phase, during which the pin, moving along the vertical axis, reaches the plate surfaces and penetrates into the material up to the shoulder, coming in contact with the upper sheet surfaces. Of course, the pin is rotating at the velocity chosen to perform the welding. Then there is the secondary plunging phase, during which the tool shoulder penetrates underneath the top surface, so attaining the right frictional contact. Throughout these and previous phases, the feed rate of the tool along the vertical axis was kept at a constant velocity. Then there is the welding phases, during which the tool, rotating on the same position, softens the material through frictional heating. The importance of these phases is to achieve the correct amount of frictional heat and the correct softening of the material to start the process. Then there is the welding phase, during which the tool is advanced along the joint line and the weld is realized. At the very end, the tool is moved along the vertical axis again and leaves the joints, and the joint is achieved. At the end, there is a kind of keyhole that will be discussed in the next slide, that is a technological sign of this particular process. As can be understood, the forces arising during the process are very high and are depending on the material to be welded and the thickness of the sheets to be welded. To achieve a proper welding, a complex clamping system is required because the parts to be welded should be fixed during the process. So the design of the clamping system is extremely important for the process. It can be seen that there are two parts that are of fundamental importance to achieve good joints. The first one is the design of the tool. The second one is the design of the clamping system that, as shown in this picture, can be extremely complex. Once a good tool and a good clamping system are designed, then we have to choose the proper process parameter to achieve a sound weld joint. The contribution of intense plastic deformation and high temperature exposure within the seared zone during friction sear welding results in recrystallization and development of texture within the seared zone and precipitated dissolution and coarsening within and around the seared zone. Based on microstructural characterization of grains and precipitates, three distinct zones, seared, nugget zone, thermomechanical affected zone, and heat affected zone, have been identified as shown. The microstructural changes in various zones have significant effect on post-weld mechanical properties. Therefore, the microstructural evolution during friction sear welding has been studied by a number of investigators. So let's define in details the different metallurgical zones just pointed out. First one, nugget zone. Intense plastic deformation and frictional heating during friction sear welding result in generation of a recrystallized fine-grained microstructure within the nugget zone. This region is usually referred to as nugget zone or dynamically recrystallized zone. Under some friction sear welding condition, an onion ring structure was observed in this zone. In the interior of recrystallized grains, usually there is low dislocation density. However, some investigators reported that small recrystallized grains of the nugget zone contain high density of sub-boundary subgrains and dislocation. The interface between the recrystallized nugget zone and the parent material is relatively diffuse on the retreating side of the tool, but quite sharp on the advancing side of the tool. Once again, friction sear welding is an asymmetric process, so slightly different metallurgical features can be appreciated on advancing side or retreating side. Depending on processing parameter, tool geometry, temperature of workpiece, and thermal conductivity of the material, various shapes of nugget zone have been observed. Basically, nugget zone can be classified into two types: basin-shaped nugget that widens near the upper surface, and elliptical nugget. Regarding the grain size, it's well accepted that the dynamic recrystallization during the process results in a generation of fine and equiaxed grains in this area. Friction sear welding parameters, tool geometry, composition of workpiece, temperature of the workpiece, vertical pressure, and active cooling exert significant influence on the size of the recrystallized grains in friction sear welding material. Several mechanisms have been proposed for dynamic recrystallization process in aluminum alloys, such as discontinuous dynamic recrystallization, continuous dynamic recrystallization and geometric dynamic recrystallization. Texture influences a variety of properties, including strength, ductility, formability, and corrosion resistance. As mentioned earlier, the friction-seal welded material consists of distinct microstructural zones: nugget, thermomechanical affected zone, heat affected zone, and base material. Each zone has different thermomechanical history. What is even more complicated for friction seal welding is that the nugget region consists of subdomains. For example, the top layer undergoes deformation by the shoulder after the pin has passed through. In addition, depending on the tool rotation rate and tremor speed, the nugget region can contain ring pattern or other microstructural variation. Let's consider now the thermomechanical affected zone. Unique to friction seal welding process is the creation of a transition zone, thermomechanical affected zone, between the parent material and the nugget zone. This area experiences both temperature and deformation during the process. This area is characterized by highly deformed structure. The parent metal elongated grains were deformed in an upward flowing pattern around the nugget zone. Although this area underwent plastic deformation, recrystallization did not occur in this area due to the insufficient deformation strain achieved. So, the very important difference between nugget zone and thermomechanical affected zone is that in nugget zone a fully recrystallized material is achieved, while in thermomechanical affected zone no recrystallization has been observed. So this is the main difference between the two areas. However, dissolution of some precipitates was observed in the thermomechanical affected zone due to high temperature exposure during the process. The extent of dissolution, of course, depends on the thermal cycle experienced by this area. Furthermore, it was revealed that the grains in the thermomechanical affected zone usually contain a high density of sub-boundaries. Lastly, the heat affected zone, that is common to all the welding processes. Beyond the thermomechanical affected zone, there is this area, the heat affected zone. This zone experiences a thermal cycle but does not undergo any plastic deformation. So, the heat affected zone can be defined as an area experiencing a temperature rise above 250 degrees. This area retains the same grain structure of the parent material, but of course this exposure to high temperature exerts a significant effect on the grain size and precipitate structure. In the picture reported in the slide, the different areas are marked. In the next slides, we will see an example of the microstructure in the different metallurgical areas for an aluminum joint. In this slide, the metallurgical areas described previously are clearly shown, so it's possible to appreciate the nugget with the typical onion ring structure. It's also possible to see thermomechanical affected zone and heat affected zone. In the picture are also reported advancing and retreating side, and it's possible to see that the shape of the nugget zone is different in the two areas. Also, this suggests the asymmetricity of the process that should be considered when designing the process. In the next slide, more in-depth microstructure of an aluminum joints will be presented and shown. In this slide, the different metallurgical areas are shown. The slide is referred to aluminum 2024 T4 friction seal welder joint in butt joint configuration. First, it's possible to appreciate the base microstructure made of pancakes grains, typical of rolled sheets. Here, it's possible to see the nugget with a fully recrystallized grains with very small dimension and equiaxis clearly seen. Then, it's possible to see the typical onion ring shape as described before. Here we can see the boundary region between the base material and the nugget zone. It's possible to see the very, very deformed grains, but still with a pancake structure. This is the thermomechanical affected zone, where the grains are highly deformed, but are not recrystallized. So this is the, as previously described, thermomechanical affected zone. Friction seal welding involves complex material movement and plastic deformation. Welding parameters, tool geometry, and joint design exert significant effect on the material flow pattern and temperature distribution, thereby influencing the microstructure evolution of the material. so influencing mechanical and electrochemical properties of the joint. In the next section, we'll try to discuss the effect of the main process parameters. In friction stir welding, two parameters are very important: tool rotation rate in clockwise or counterclockwise direction and tool travel speed along the line of the joint. The rotation of tool results in stirring and mixing of material around the rotation pin, and the translation of the tool moves the stirred material from the front to back of the pin and finishes welding processes. Higher tool rotation rates generate higher temperature because of higher friction heating and results in more intense stirring and mixing of material, as will be discussed later. However, it should be noted that frictional coupling of tool surface with workpiece is going to govern the heating. In addition to the tool rotational rate and travel speed, another important process parameter is the angle of spine or spindle or tool tilt with respect to the workpiece surface. The tool travel speed also influences the temperature arisen during the process. Higher is the tool travel speed, lower is the temperature achieved. The initial dwelling time, the tool tilt angle as defined, the tool plunge depth and the tool design and tool plunging force are the most influential factor on friction stir welding. Tool geometry is the most influential aspect of process development. The tool geometry plays a critical role in material flow and, in turn, governs the travel rate at which friction stir welding can be conducted. A friction stir welding tool, as previously mentioned, consists of a shoulder and a pin, as shown in the previous slide. As mentioned earlier, the tool has two primary functions: the localized heating and the material flow. In the initial stage of tool plunge, the heating results primarily from the friction between pin and workpiece. Some additional heating results from deformation of material. The tool is plunged till the shoulder touches the workpiece. The friction between the shoulder and the workpiece results in the biggest component of heating. From the heating aspect, the relative size of pin and shoulder is important, and the other design features are not critical. The shoulder also provides confinement for the heated volume of material. The second function of the tool is to stir and move the material. The uniformity of microstructure and property, as well as process loads, are governed by the tool design. Generally, a concave shoulder and threaded cylindrical pins are used. But with increasing experience and some improvement in understanding of material flow, the tool geometry has evolved significantly. Complex features have been added to alter the material flow, mixing and reduce process loads. For example, some tools are shown in this slide. Some of them were developed by the Welding Institute in Cambridge. The pins depicted in these pictures are a very complex geometry that is conceived to increase the amount of stirring material and to reduce the forces required to obtain the welding. In particular, these design features are believed to reduce welding forces, enable an easier flow of plasticized material, and facilitate downward auguring effect and increase the interface between the pin and the plasticized material, thereby increasing heat generation. In this slide, different designs for the tool shoulder are presented. The design of the tool shoulder is extremely important because, as said before, the shoulder generates the frictional heat and also the shoulder provides the confinement for the material under plastic deformation. So, through the years, different designs for the shoulder geometry have been proposed, and in this slide, we can see some hypotheses of complex shoulder geometry design. The materials to be used for the construction of friction stir welding tools should have some characteristics. First of all, they need to have a low thermal conductivity, because a material with a high thermal conductivity will take off the heat from the joining to the tool, that is not good for the joining formation. Then, this material should have a high wear resistance, because the tool is subjected to an intensive wear action. Moreover, the material used for the tool building should be chemically inert with respect to the material to be welded to avoid contamination of the welded joints. Of course, the material to be used for tool construction should have high mechanical properties at high temperature. Also, this material should have a high dimensional stability. Also, those materials should have high hot corrosion resistance, and of course, the mechanical properties of the material of the tool should be much higher than the mechanical properties of the material to be welded at the same temperature. This results in the fact that the materials to be used for the tool construction are very expensive material. How expensive? Depending on the material to be welded. If you have to weld aluminum, you can use, for instance, stainless steel tools. But if you have to weld stainless steel, maybe you will need a much stronger material. For instance, in the friction seal welding of titanium, you will need a very hard alloy to build the tool. Usually, those are customized alloy, especially conceived for the building of friction seal welding tools that can be also very, very expensive. The most convenient joint configuration for friction seal welding are butt and lap joints. A simple square butt joint is shown in the picture in this slide. Two plates or sheets with the same thickness are placed on backing plate and clamped firmly to prevent the butting joint faces from being forced apart. During the initial plunge of the tool, the forces are fairly large and extra care is required to ensure that plates in butt configuration do not separate. A rotating tool is plunged into the joint line and traversed along this line when the shoulder of the tool is in intimate contact with the surface of plates, producing a weld along a butting line. On the other hand, for a simple lap joint, two lapped plates or sheets are clamped on a backing plate. A rotating tool is vertically plunged through the upper plate into the lower plate and traversed along the desired direction, joining the two plates. Many other configurations can be produced by combination of butt and lap joints. Apart from butt and lap joint configuration, other types of joint design, such as fillet joints, are also possible as needed for some engineering application. In this slide, we will see some of these particular configuration. It's important to note that no special preparation is needed for friction seal welding of butt and lap joints. Two clean metal plates can be easily joined together in the form of butt or lap joints, without any major concern about the surface condition of the plates, and no preparation is required to perform the joining process. This also results in a more environmentally friendly process with respect to other welding technique, where a preparation with the plates to be joints is required. During the rotation of the friction sear welding tool inside the workpiece, a system of three forces is generated: axial, welding, and transverse forces. The axial force, which is F zeta in this slide, tends to lift the tool. The welding force, which is Fx in this slide, is the result of the tool advancing along the welding joint. A combination of the rotation of the tool and the welding movement results in an asymmetric flow field around the tool. This flow field generates a transverse force, Fy, in this slide, on the tool in the direction perpendicular to that of the linear motion. So, three forces arises, as summarized in this slide, Fx, Fz, and Fy. The torque is also important. The torque in friction seal welding has been the subject of several studies for its relevance to the control of the process and to the improvement of tool design. Torque is directly related to weld quality since it represents a measure of the shear stress and is responsible for plastic flow and heat generation. In addition, several studies show that the torque decays with increasing tool rotational speed and, with less influence, increases with the welding speed. The process, moreover, can be divided in two regions: material shear, which occurs in front of the rotating tool, and material extrusion in the back. The forces acting in front of the tool are higher than the forces acting at the back of the tool. The welding force and the transverse force are supposed to oscillate as a function of time, with a non-zero mean value in the positive direction x and y, respectively. In this slide, the typical trend of Fz and Fx, so the axial force and welding force recorded during the butt welding of an aluminum alloy, have been reported. So, let's go to observe the curves in more detail and let's attempt a discussion of the forces recording depending on the physics of the process. So, let's correlate the forces with the different stage of the welding process. Let's start with the axial force, F zeta, which is the higher. So first important lesson is that the actual force is always higher than the welding force. This is something that we should consider in designing the machine and choosing the process parameter. So, looking at the F zeta forces, two peaks can be observed. The former peak represents the force acting on the pin to achieve the penetration within the workpiece at the first stage of the process. Then, the pin insertion proceeds with some instability phenomena revealed by some other peaks following this first one, and due to the material still being cold. Straight afterward, the frictional heat generated by the pin softens the alloy, so that the vertical force undergoes a little decay. The latter peak, the second one, always higher than the first one, is attributed to the shoulder contact with the workpiece. So it's when the shoulder is in contact with the surface of the workpiece. When the shoulder reaches the material and penetrates into the surface of the top sheets, the vertical force again increases due to both the added frictional work and the larger amount of material to be stirred. But during the dwelling phase, the F zeta decreases due to the softening of the material induced by the frictional heat. At the beginning of the welding phase, F zeta starts rising again quickly, but when the process attains the steady state, the vertical force reaches a relative steady state value during the translational state. The vertical force is significantly higher than the other forces, and it's therefore the limiting factor in machine design. It is also the force that mostly influences the wear and, when it occurs, the failure of the tool, particularly during the plunge stages. Concerning the welding force, the horizontal force Fx, conversely to what was observed for the axial force, this force Fx simply oscillates around zero up to the beginning of the welding phase, when it suddenly reaches a stationary value that keeps until the tool pin stops. Such a behavior, because Fx is the welding force and indicates the resistance acting on the tool as it moves along the weld line, so it is almost zero during the plunging and dwelling phases, and quickly reaches a stationary value when the tool begins its travel along the welding path. Fy, that is the transversal force, is less important because it's the force that should be contained by the clamping system, but usually is well lower than Fx and Fz. In this slide, some of the advantages of friction seal welding can be summarized. So, no fusion occurs, so the material never melts, so we will avoid all the defects related to melting and consequent solidification of material. It's possible to weld materials difficult to weld. It's possible to weld titanium, aluminum, and so on. It's possible to weld dissimilar material. We will join, for instance, aluminum to copper. We will even join aluminum to polymers that can be of great amount of interest for a lot of industrial application. There is no needing of processes or shielding gases. No filler material is required. The preparation of the components to be welded is extremely simple and doesn't require complex preparation processes. The process can be fully automated by using CNC machines. It's possible to join thick sheets in a single pass, up to 50 millimeters in a single pass, depending, of course, on the tool geometry and on the maximum load capacity of the machine used. No certification needed for welding operation, is environmentally friendly, and operative costs are quite low compared to other welding techniques. On the other hand, some disadvantages are linked to friction stir welding. First of all, the difficulty to weld complex geometry. As shown before, friction stir welding particularly fits for butt joints or lap joints. For complex geometry, it's difficult to achieve a good welding. At the same time, it's very difficult to weld along complex pattern, where a complex welding pattern is required. Maybe laser welding or electron beam welding are better choices. The high cost of the equipment, while the operating costs are quite low compared to other welding techniques, the equipment can be very expensive, so this is a disadvantage. So the high forces arising during the process and the needing for very stiff fixed tools and machines, and complex tool design that require a lot of experiences before being able to design an effective tool for complex geometry or for high-strength material. Friction sear welding process may produce a joint not free of defects. These defects can reduce the mechanical properties of the joint and limit the service life of the component. There are several important factors that can promote the formation of defects during the welding. These factors are unsuitable main weld parameters, for instance, weld speed, rotational speed, tool design, tilt angle, plunge force and depth, pin offset, and workpiece thickness and fixing. The typical defects that can be observed are thunder, groove, lack of penetration, kissing bond, swirl, dipping, run-out hole, excessive flash. Some of these defects can be seen through a visual inspection, some others are blind, so post-weld controls are required to detect the formation of one or more of these defects. In the next slides, we will analyze in details these defects. Tunnel and voids are commonly found in the similar weld joints at the advancing side, close to the bottom of the weld zone, due to insufficient material flow and poor mixing. Also, this defect is formed when there is a formation of a big layer of intermetallic compounds. Also, these defects will appear when the inappropriate weld parameters are used. The parameters which are most influent on tunnel formation are travel speed, rotational speed, tool design, and tool plunging. This defect is mostly to occur when the heat generated is not sufficient to generate a good mixing of the material. Examples of voids and tunnel defects has been found by some researcher mainly in dissimilar joints. In this slide is shown a typical tunnel defects where a lack of material can be observed. Of course, these are blind defects, so this cannot be detected through visual inspection. Surface defects like grooves, rough texture, cracks, or surface lack of fill are common in friction sear welding, and one of the most affecting factors is shoulder contact surface, in particular the design and the geometries of the shoulder surface. It's worth to recall that shoulder can be concave, convex, flat with special profile, or with special features like scrolled ridges, grooves, concentrating circles. All of these features have a different impact on the formation of those surface defects. Usually, surface grooves can be seen at the upper surface of the weld. The formation of this defect is promoted by an insufficient heat input. The occurrence of these defects can be limited by applying a higher plunging and a higher forces. Also, as the friction sear welding tool shoulder rotates and moves along the workpiece surface, it leaves behind tool markings like feed marks in machining and affecting the surface rough texture. This kind of surface appearance is more than a technological signature of the process rather than a defect. When the interfaces between the two plates to be joined are not completely welded at the root of the weld bed, this defect is called the lack of penetration. This defect can be due to an insufficient length of the pin, can be also attributed to an insufficient steering of the material. This defect is particularly dangerous because promotes a concentration of the stresses and also reduces the life of the component in service. It's also a difficult defect to be seen, so to appreciate the lack of penetration, non-destructive testing evaluation are required. A typical weld defect occurring in friction sear welding is the kissing bond. A kissing bond is a specific defect for solid-state joint technique. The kissing bond occurs where two previously separate or separated regions of the material are in contact with little or no metallic bond present. The kissing bond usually has a slightly reduced static load carrying capacity, but impact strength and possibly fatigue life can be significantly impaired. Swirl is another typical defect of frictionless welding, and it occurs where an instability of plastic flow is achieved. Usually, this defect is due to an inadequate pin design or due to an excessive plunging force during the process. This instability in material flow results in an inhomogeneous weld bed with reduced mechanical properties for the joint. When this kind of defect is achieved, it is extremely difficult to repair the joints, so a big deal of attention must be paid in the design of the tool, in particular in the design of the pin, to avoid the occurrence of this kind of defect when performing friction stir welding. Dipping defects occurs in friction stir welding when an excessive plunging force is applied. It results in a reduction of the thickness in the weld bed, so in a reduction of the cross-section area of the wool joint. This defect is extremely dangerous for mechanical properties of the joint, so the vertical plunging force must be carefully controlled, and the values to be adopted must be carefully chosen during the definition of the process condition. In friction stir welding process, after finishing the weld line, the non-consumable stir pin is pulled out from its endpoint location. This causes a defect type known as exit tool or endpoint. This defect will appear in the final location of the welding process, leaving a critical hole behind. This defect is unfavorable in friction stir welding due to high stress concentration point and also weaken the weld joint mechanical properties. The presence of this type of defects depending on one factor only, which is pulling up the stir pin action from the weld line. Therefore, skipping this action during the process can produce a joint with better mechanical properties and defect-free weld, thus leaving the exit hole in the ruined sacrificial plate or runoff wedge, or using a semi-consumable stir pin can solve the end hole problem in the weld joint. Also, in modern time, some retractable pin tools have been designed to try to avoid the formation of this defect. The flash defect can be defined as a solidified wave of material that are pulled out from the joint and can be seen on the side of the friction stir weld joint. This kind of defect is due to an excessive heat input or an excessive vertical plunging force or an inadequate design of the shoulder of the tool that is not able to keep the material within the weld bed. This defect should be avoided. It's very easily to be detected because it can be seen through visual inspection. And when this defect occurs, the joint can be machined to remove the flash. But please consider that this material that is outside is material that is not within the weld bed, so maybe internal tunnel or pores can be detected when an excessive flash is achieved. In the next slides, we are going to see the equipment used to perform friction stir welding. First of all, CNC working center can be used. In friction stir welding, you need a very stiff clamping system to hold the pieces to be weld. Then you need a spindle to activate the tool. So at the first time, CNC working center have been used to perform friction stir welding process. The only problem is the forces that this machining center can exert on the tool and on the material. So usually this kind of solution have been used for material with low mechanical properties, such as aluminum, or for joints of low thickness, up to 2 or 3 millimeters in butt joint configuration. Dedicated equipment, such as the one in this picture, have been developed to increase the forces during the process, so are able to weld thicker sheets or are able to weld high strength material. This kind of equipment usually have the same concept of a CNC machine, but the frame is bigger, so also the fixtures are stiffer. So with this equipment, you can weld higher thicknesses or you can weld difficult to weld or high strength materials. Robotic arms can also be used to hold the spindle and the tool. Of course, by using robotic arm, you can perform more complex welding path, but the forces that you can apply are extremely low. So usually this kind of configuration is used to weld low properties materials, such as polymers, for instance, but are used when a very complex a welding path is required and when the forces are low. This solution is very good for polymers or for composite material. In the last years, one of the latest developments in frictionless welding is the joining of composites or the joining of polymers. In this slide, an interesting application is reported, the welding of tailored blank. For tailored blank, a joint between two sheets with a different thickness is intended. This kind of joint is very common in automotive and in naval industry. With the frictionless welding, when the process parameters and the tool design are correctly set, it is possible to weld together sheets with a different thickness and even more sheets of dissimilar material with a different thickness. For instance, if you have to weld an automotive structure, maybe you want to weld an aluminum sheet to a steel sheet of different thicknesses. Frictionless welding is the welding technique that can allow you to obtain this kind of joint. In the slide is shown the typical configuration as a scheme and is also shown the cross-section micrograph of a dissimilar joint between steel and aluminum sheets of different thickness. Here an important parameter shows up, which is the offset of the tool. In this kind of application, the pin is not centered with respect to the welding line, but there is an offset in one of the two sheets. Usually the one with the best mechanical properties to achieve a better heating up and a better material mixing in the more resistant material. So, when welding tailored blanks or in general when welding the similar material, an offset of the tool should be considered when the mechanical properties or the thickness of the two material are really different. An interesting possibility offered by frictionless welding is to weld dissimilar material, for instance aluminum to copper. As you may know, aluminum and copper are completely unmeasurable from a metallurgical point of view, so to weld aluminum and copper with the fusion welding technique is almost impossible. Frictionless welding allows you to weld very dissimilar material because the welding can also be based on a mechanical interlocking between the plastic flow of the two materials. What is even more important, with the frictionless welding you can weld metals to polymer. Well, while the joining of aluminum and copper is a quite consolidated one through frictionless welding, the joining of metals to polymer is still in its early stage, so a lot of research more should be done before this application can become an industrial application, but the path is clear to see. So another interesting possibility of frictionless welding is the joining of dissimilar material, aluminum to copper. Just to give an example of two materials that are extremely difficult or even impossible to weld with traditional fusion welding technique, but looking at the future, the joining between metal and polymers can be achieved through frictionless welding, and of course, this kind of joining will open a lot of application of very high industrial interest. So, we are at the end of this lecture and we will close with some frequently asked questions. So, let's go. First one, what are the limitations of frictionless welding? The main limitations of the process are related to the forces arising during the welding and to the complexity of the welding path to be followed. So, the limitations are due to the machine used, so are due to the forces that the machine can exert on the material and due to the control of the machine, so related to the complexity of the path that can be followed by the tool. Which are the most common pieces of equipment? CNC machines, just equipped with particular fixtures to perform frictionless welding operation. What are the costs of the equipment? It depends. It depends on the dimension that you want to have, on the stiffness that you need. So they can range from few, let me say, from 10,000, 20,000 euro to 1 million of euro. So it depends on the machine. What is the temperature at the interface? Typically is like the 70% of the melting temperature of the material. So if you are welding aluminum, you can expect a temperature of 500 degrees, but more or less is the 70% of the melting temperature of the material that you are welding. What are the benefits of frictionless welding over laser or electron beam welding? Well, are the benefits related to be a solid state joining process rather than a fusion joining process. So you have a reduced affected zone, and also you have a nugget zone that is fully recrystallized, so with mechanical properties that can be even higher than the one of base material. Do parts weld better when they are preheated before friction welding? Well, sometimes some authors tried to reduce the forces required by preheating the parts to be welded. Preheating can be seen as a way to reduce the forces acting on the machine more than a way to obtain better properties. So you have to see the preheating as a way to reduce the forces arising during the process. Is there a limitation to the size of the part that can be friction welded? Well, yes, of course. The limitation is due to the forces arising during the process, so the limitation is due to the stiffness of the machine. Can you weld the similar metals, and how do you control weld quality and corrosion resistance? Yes, of course, you can weld the similar metals. To control the corrosion resistance, well, is quite difficult. So you have to properly choose the process parameters, and sometimes you have just to think about a post-welding heat treatment or a post-welding surface treatment to improve corrosion resistance. Sometimes also the weld bed can show different corrosion properties with respect to the base material, so corrosion is something that you have to consider when you figure out to friction stir weld dissimilar material. How do you non-destructively test these welds? Well, you can perform all the non-destructive evaluation that you want, of course, depending on the material that you are joining. What is the stress distribution in these welds, and how can they be relieved? To relieve stress distribution, you can perform a post-welding heat treatment, but stress distribution is something that you have to consider when you do friction stir welding. We didn't spoken of this topic during this lecture because we had only 1 hour, but residual stress is an important topic in friction stir welding. What some authors do is to do a post-welding heat treatment, and what you can do to reduce the occurrences of residual stresses is to minimize the heat input and is to properly design the fixtures. So the clamping system should be properly designed to reduce the occurrence of residual stresses. Thank you for attending this lecture, and I hope you enjoyed my presentation. And also, I hope that this presentation can be useful for you and for your company. If you have any doubts, if you want to speak more about friction stir welding, for every need that you can have, please feel free to send me a mail to my contacts. The first one is the official one of the University of Naples, the second one is my personal one. So, see you around, and thank you again for attending this lecture.